Okay, welcome everyone. It is so good to see all of you. And thank you for joining us tonight for our first ever How to Plan a Reunion webinar. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Rona Wilk, the class of 1991 and the Alumni Association of Barnard College Reunion Chair. And just a quick bit of housekeeping as a quick reminder. This event is being recorded and enables an attendee to participate through a personal device's microphone and or camera. An attendee may elect not to participate through use of a microphone and or camera. The election of an attendee to use a microphone and or camera constitutes a release and waiver of rights in the capture of the attendee's image, likeness, and or voice for the exclusive use by Barnard College. So the reasoning behind this event was, you know, why should every class have to try and reinvent the wheel every year for a reunion? There are so many classes with so many good ideas. Why not share them and help inspire others? So here we are, and we'll go through kind of the basic planning process of reunion, and we'll let our guest contributors jump in to tell about their experiences. And I'll be joining both as AABC reunion chair and as a class officer myself, who's planned some reunions. And then we'll leave some time at the end for Q&A. First though, to address the elephant in the room. No, we still don't know exactly what form reunion will be taking this year. Whether it's going to be a hybrid with an in-person component or whether it's going to be all virtual. We of course are hoping for the former. But you, as your class representatives, you should plan for any eventuality. And we'll talk a little bit about the focus on content and versatility. But that's also why we have class representatives from classes who have planned virtual reunions and those who have done in-person reunions as well. Although I do wanna add that virtual events in general, we're finding are great for connecting to your class, especially members who are not in the immediate New York City area. So no matter what happens this year, we encourage you to think about including a virtual element in your plans, or at least think about virtual mini reunions in general. But let's start with just regular reunion. I wanna introduce you all to Lacey Beck, class of 2014, the Senior Associate Director of Alumni Engagement, and Georgiana Poindexter, Administrative Assistant in Alumni Relations, who are primary alumni relations liaisons for reunion and total rock stars. And joining us for today's session are six class reunion committee members from the past few years, Carol Dickert and Ruth Cowan from 1961, Wendy White, Jean Peterson, and Melissa Hubsher from 1981, and Judy Gould from 1969. And they'll be sharing advice and takeaways from their own reunion experiences throughout the presentation and will help us answer any questions at the end. Please note, if you have any questions throughout the presentation, please feel free to drop them in the chat or you can save them for the Q&A at the end. Additionally, we welcome you to change your name to include your class year if you have not already done so. And to kick us off, we wanted to share a brief reunion planning overview. So first slide, please. Okay, so reunion 2022 is going to be June 9th through the 11th. As we just noted, the format is still TBD. And we just wanted to let you know a little bit about, so there's the AABC Reunion Committee, of which I am the chair, and we are responsible. We're a group of alums from all different classes, and we are in charge of the overall all-class reunion events. So, you know, the events that you sign up for, whether it's a faculty lecture or if it's in person, the lunch or whatever, those kind of events come from us, alumni panels and such. Alumni Relations helps us create that set of events, and they also are here to help you. Every class has an assigned liaison in Alumni Relations who will be your guiding light to creating your reunion. And you should feel free to reach out to them. They'll be assigned soon. Once they are, and once you start to have your first meetings, you should feel free to reach out to them with questions, ideas, et cetera. Now, the role of the class reunion committees, as I'm sure many of you know, but especially if this is your first time planning a reunion, you are responsible for your individual classes activities. So during in-person times, that would often mean a Thursday night cocktail party. If you wanted some sort of speaker or special event or special presentation at your class dinner, or if you wanted to have some sort of special lunch presentation, that sort of stuff is set up through your class committee. And the class committee itself is comprised composed of class officers. Of course, we invite all of you to be part of that. The vice president is actually the official head of the class committee. We welcome the class agents, the class fundraising agents, as that's also a big component, using your reunion year to raise some funds for the college. But we also want to make everybody is welcome to join the committee. And one of the things we're going to talk about next is about class outreach and getting as many people involved and to attend reunion as possible. So joining your class reunion committee, one of the things we want to stress with this is that, at least what I've found, and some of our panelists may want to jump in because I know some of you had very robust outreach activity, is what we found is that personalized outreach is really the best. You will be sending, at the very least, a fall and a spring class email through Alumnae Relations in the fall, basically a sort of save the date and reminding everyone it's a reunion year, maybe ramping up some fundraising, and then in the spring with the more particulars of your actual class events and dates and times. But what I found, like for instance, reaching out to two classmates who attended an online class event that we did, who had never really been involved before, but they were really into the event. And so I reached out to them and said, hey, you know, you had such a good time. Do you want to come and join our reunion committee for our class? You can represent the West Coast because they're both in California. And especially for virtual events, we wanted to make sure we had a nice geographic diversity. So that's super important. And you can also use mini reunions, which I know the class of 1961 had a series of smaller sort of cocktail hours leading up to the June reunion. So if any of you guys want to talk about that and your different outreach, that would be fantastic if anyone wants to jump in.
I'll jump in because I was the 61 reunion chair.
This is Ruth. Is that you?
Yeah, it's Ruth.
Okay, sorry. It's just that people may or may not be able to see you on their screen. So okay. Ruth Cowan.
Ruth Cowan, class of 61, and I was the reunion chair. And by the time I got to thinking about planning reunion, we had been in lockdown Zoom world for 6 months. And I had attended a lot of Zoom meetings, and I had also attended, sadly, a fair number of Zoom shivas. And it was those two experiences that led me to think that this is a golden opportunity to open up the reunion committee to women who don't live in New York. I had served on reunion committees off and on over the 60 years since we graduated. And it had always been people in New York. Occasionally we had somebody who wasn't in New York and went, when the technology developed so that you could put a telephone connection on a table and with a microphone, we could have somebody who wasn't in New York, but it was very awkward. Basically it was all New Yorkers. And so I began to put together the reunion committee with the idea not of asking for volunteers, but of knowing people who love reunions, who've come to reunions all the time, and who are all over the world. In the end, we had people from, we had classmates, we had 22 members of the reunion committee by the time we were finished. One of them in Sydney, Australia, several, one in Britain, one in France, one in Israel. We have a very large contingent of classmates who live in Israel. And it was very important to me to have someone from Israel on the reunion committee. And others scattered all over the United States. And it was a boon. It was an absolute boon to have such a large committee. And part of the reason it was a boon was that we thought, basically, we had no idea at the beginning whether we were going to have a Zoom reunion. It turned out that we did. But we thought, hey, we could use Zoom to do reunion events before reunion. And we did two kinds. One is on the screen. That was mini reunions. I think we had three lectures with breakout rooms in the months between December and May. And we called those mini reunions. But the thing we did that was really wonderful and that really connected with the reunion committee is to run virtual cocktail parties online. We had come to the conclusion that the parts of reunion that our classmates liked best was the cocktail party and the dinner. That is the times to talk to each other, not the times necessarily to listen to other people. And so we started having many reunions. We discovered that if you invited 16 people and got 12, that was the perfect amount. And in the end, I don't know how many virtual cocktail parties we ran because the reunion, members of the reunion committee just started running their own.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But they were unquestionably the part of our planning that was most important to class cohesion. I mean, we had, in the end, two Zoom sessions during reunion week. And the last time we had a reunion 6 years ago, I think 24 people showed up, right? We had 80 people all over the world.
That's great.
And so I would say on that basis, even if you have an in-person reunion, make it hybrid.
Yeah. And I will say, this is just to throw this out, it may or may not resonate, but I have a cousin who's Mount Holyoke, class of 73, and they actually are already starting to do kind of outreach. And they're actually holding these kind of mini cocktail things by major. So they're inviting anyone who is an English major to come to talk about, like, where did you end up? Did you end up using your English degree? Or are you a nuclear physicist now? And what have you. And so I think there's a lot of different kinds of ideas that you can do. We did my class did a virtual event. I wanted to just get people like used to the idea of doing a virtual event. So it wasn't something 100% completely new and out of the blue. And a lot of the people who came to that did actually come to our reunion, which was great.
In addition to doing the majors, we also had a number of other ways of getting people together for these cocktail parties. In my case, one of the ones that I ran included those of us who went to high school and college together. And wow, we had about 20 graduates of the same high school, Bronx High School of Science, who also came to Barnard, and we had a blast. It was a wonderful way to get together. Did majors as well, but that was a fun thing to do.
So I guess the takeaway is, think of commonalities, think of ways to get your class together and talking, and even ahead of a reunion, the official reunion, it sounds like. Now, did you, class of 61 in particular, did you also do, my understanding was that you did outreach to your classmates, like people called different classmates, dorm building or floors is a great idea,
well,
Diane.
That was, That was the effort that we started with, which was to discover, to get in touch with our E orphans. We discovered that on the class list, mind you, we're women in our 80s. On the class list, about a third of the people who were on the list had no email address. So, which meant that all of the outreach efforts were going to be on email and we're going to miss those folks. And so we split up that, I think the total number was 93. There were 93 classmates who had no email address. We split them up amongst the members of the reunion committee. And we called. When the calls, we discovered that a whole lot of people had moved to a different telephone number. We also discovered a whole lot of people had moved to a different address. But we had several classmates who had, of all things, been reference librarians in their careers.
I love it.
And they knew how to do the detective work. So in the end, I think we whittled down the email orphan list to about 35.
Wow. That's so.
In the process, as Lacey knows, we discovered new addresses. We got new telephone numbers.
I was just going to say, Jean, yay librarians. That's awesome.
Right.
And let me just jump into the class list thing at the bottom, just to sort of distinguish. So as you can hear, you know, updating it and finding out missing contact info is invaluable, and especially now where so much of the contact between alums and the college is virtual or is over email. That's a really important bit of it. Lacey, did you want to jump in?
Yeah, one thing, and I think, so as Rona mentioned, there will be, you know, an alumni relations liaison assigned to each class. And I think that just something that's important to keep in mind is that basically there are two different versions of the class list. They all come from the same place. So like people's contact information on both lists is the same, because they're pulled from our database. But the important thing to know is that the list that your alumni relations liaison will provide basically can be used for any reunion outreach. But when you are doing any fundraising outreach, you have to use the list that your individual giving officer, formerly known as annual giving, can provide, because there are people who have requested to be removed from fundraising solicitations. So I just wanted to share that piece of information because I know it can get a little bit confusing, but basically, you know, you'll have your assigned alumni relations and individual giving staff members at your, you know, meetings. And so they will be able to also expand on this. But also, I think another important thing is just if you are discovering, you know, that you find someone's email address that was incorrect on our list that we've given you, please ask the person if it's okay to share this with Barnard, with Alumni Relations, because so as probably many of you know, not everyone wants their information to be shared with us. So we appreciate you, you know, asking and then sharing it with us if they want to be on the list, because we want to make sure as many people as possible who want to receive reunion correspondence receive it. So
and a lot of times it's simply just a matter of someone just kind of fell out of touch, you know, and it's not that they're actively avoiding the college. They just are kind of, you know, out of the loop. Let's bring them back in. The more the merrier. Just to then go back up to class communication. So as we said, there'll be a fall and spring class email. And, you know, those can be as formulaic or as eccentrically dedicated to your class as you want them to be. The class of 1981, I know you guys did a terrific letter around the number 40, since it was your 40th reunion. And just so so if you want to talk a little bit about that, but also just to let everybody know, again, you don't have to start from scratch. You can, we encourage that. We're happy for you to do that. But we can also provide you with examples of previous letters that you can, you know, tailor to your own classes, interest and style.
I just want to jump in here for a minute. Judy Gould.
Okay, this is Judy from class of 69.
Yep. Class of 69, and we have the distinction of having the last in-person reunion. It was our 50th, and
in-person reunions are so old school now.
So the key, I think, for us in finding and generating enthusiasm for a committee was casting a very, very, very wide net, as a lot of people have spoken about. And how we did that was a lot of ways too. I mean, some of us who were in the New York area were coming to events on campus and seeing people, classmates, and speaking to them in person. But it was just the idea of everybody knows somebody and call your freshman roommate and, you know, bring that enthusiasm to them. The idea being that for us, it was about generating and brainstorming as many ideas as possible for events and to find out what people were interested in. As soon as they spoke about it, they owned it, kind of, you know, and we were successful in getting a large group on our committee and continuing to be enthusiastic, engaging, and bringing the excitement to them. And I think that really worked. And I can only imagine that the virtual is, it has so many opportunities for seeing people, as you were, as Ruth and Carol and Rona were sharing. I think it's great. And many of the programming, I think, that we did in person can certainly be translated to virtual. I'm complete.
Fantastic. 81, do you want to jump in here or do you want to wait until our next slide?
Sure, I'll jump in. Although I have to say that I can take no credit for our clever, fun facts about the number 40 letter, which was really the work of Meg Story, our classmate who isn't on the Zoom this evening. But she went out and found all of these fun facts about the number 40, like it's the only number in English whose letters appear in alphabetical order. And the Italian word for 40 is quaranta, which is where we get the famous or infamous word quarantine. And there are 40 spaces on a Monopoly board. And a typical pregnancy lasts 40 weeks. And WD-40 is called WD-40 because it took chemists 40 tries to come up with the winning formula. And we put these into our email invitation to get everybody excited about 40. But Wendy and Melissa, do either of you know how Meg came up with that? More backstory than I have?
I do not. Wendy?
Hi, it's Wendy. I do not. I think she just, I started off with, I love the saying, life begins at 40. And so it's a very important number in the Bible, and life did get better when I turned 40. So we started off with that and we did brainstorming on the committee. And that's when Meg, I think, presented us the list of top 10 about 40. So we had to kind of fine tune it. It's what I call brainstorming.
Yeah, and it definitely underscores the importance of casting your net wide for your reunion committee, because Meg is not one of our class officers.
That's right.
But she came up with this brilliant idea. And
that's
also
a great point.
I'm trying to think all the different places that we had people from on our reunion committee, at least as far away as Italy. So we had people all the way from, you know, the West Coast to the East Coast and across the Atlantic to Central Europe because we were on Zoom. And I'm sure that people came to our reunion who would not have been able to afford to come in person, either not afford the time or not afford the money, but were able to afford a Zoom
Right.
From Israel as well.
Right. Israel and from Austria at times. And it was very special. I think the idea of having a reunion committee and expanding it and spreading the wealth. And we've been involved with the Barnard ever since graduating, this core team, but it was wonderful to reconnect with some who we haven't seen each other really in 40 years. And they were so happy to be back to join hands to help get our reunion going. So
fantastic.
Be very inclusive.
And Rona, I'd like to add something if you don't mind.
Please.
Another reason we were so glad to have a large reunion committee is that actually creating online events, the two that we did at the time at reunion, one of which was just a series of virtual cocktail parties, but the other was a speaker and breakout rooms and a photo montage. That took an enormous
amount. That is on our next slide.
Okay, then I'll talk about how many people had to cooperate in order to get that done.
Okay. So, all right. So I think we should probably move on to the next slide, but just to one last thing is social media outreach. You know, my class after our last reunion, not this past one before the 25th, we finally put together a class Facebook page. And honestly, it has been more effective in, and granted, we're of a generation that actually still is on Facebook. So I can't really speak to a younger generation, but for our class, we have like 200 people on it, and which is like more than I think anyone, the number of people who have attended any event for our class since we graduated are on our Facebook page. And so if you don't have some sort of social media outreach for your class, thank you. Angela Lehman, who is also a member of Alumni Relations team, says that young alums are using Facebook groups too, hooray. It's always nice to be an old trendsetter. So we encourage you to set up some sort of social media outreach, again, for recruitment purposes, to advertise your events, to solicit things for a video montage or class book, which we'll get to in a second. So I think let's move on to our next slide, which is about event planning. So right, this is it. This is the crux of the committee activity. As we said, it may be hybrid, it may be virtual. You should plan for anything. And the best advice we can give you actually comes from our wonderful Georgiana Poindexter, who basically said, you know, focus on the content right now. Focus on what you think your class is interested in, what they would be interested in hearing or hearing who they would like to hear from, what kinds of activities they would find interesting. And ideally come up with ideas that would work in either setting, either online or in person. And we can refine the delivery method later, but if you come up with good core content, you should be good to go no matter what happens in June. So one of the things that a lot of classes do is select a speaker, either from their own class. Sometimes they ask a faculty member, or they want to ask a faculty member to come and give a lecture. And that both of those ideas are great. I'm sure there are other possibilities as well. The one thing we want to emphasize for speaker selection and outreach is please go through your alumni relations liaison when you want to do outreach to a prospective speaker. There's a whole bunch of different protocols and things, especially for faculty. We have to talk to the provost. It's not just hey, pick up the phone and be like, hey, Professor so-and-so, come speak at our thing, right? There is actually a process and a protocol, and we ask you to please go through that process just so that everybody knows what's going on. And normally it's not a problem. We just need to kind of go by the book. And the same thing with your speakers for your class. In particular, if it's someone who is, kind of high up in the in their field or what have you. We had a speaker who is very, very high up in the entertainment industry. And so we ended up Alumnae Relations more or less ended up coordinating with her assistant. She was more than happy to do it, and we were more than happy to have her. And a member of our committee was the interviewer. And so, like, you know, you'll kind of get a feel of, okay, if it's someone on the committee, obviously just ask them. But if it's anyone else, again, please talk to Alumnae Relations. Lacey?
And I think another reason for it is, since we are at the same time trying to coordinate events for all classes, if there's someone who the AABC reunion committee has in mind for, you know, like a panel or something, then we might try to, you know, spread the wealth and ask for, you know, try to find different panelists. And, you know, if we do end up needing to ask the same person for multiple events, trying to make sure that we coordinate the times and everything to make sure that is possible. So that's kind of another important reason behind that as well.
Rona, can I just say one thing about speakers? Our reunion committee made a conscious decision not to invite a member of our class to speak, because we did not want somebody in our class to be the expert to whom everybody else was asking questions. We just thought that wasn't the tone we wanted for our reunion.
Mm-hmm. I can jump in for a second and say that we had two very successful class-specific events that classmates stepped up to own. One, they were both facilitated conversations. One was Speak Up, Speak Out, addressing the events of 1968 and transformative cultural and social events going on throughout the world, assassinations, et cetera. How did those impact us? And that was very well attended. And that we were also looking to cast a very wide net there and draw people in who weren't especially political, but who may, those events may have affected in a negative way. We just want to hear from everybody. And the other event that was very successful facilitated discussion and conversation, because I agree, we just want to talk to each other, was a kind of maybe a taboo subject, aging and how I see my future. 50 is a milestone. They're all milestone reunions, but you know, we're looking at, well, there's fewer years ahead of us than there were behind us. So that was very well attended and it went very well. And I think that kind of a thing would also lend itself to breakout rooms, virtual, and coming back together after the breakout rooms for wider sharing.
Fantastic, thank you, Judy.
Yeah.
So, you know, a couple of the things that were successful virtually at reunion this past year were things like we did a Barnard Bingo event, which actually I had created for my class, and then we expanded it to work for the whole college, where we had a list of different Barnard things, whether it was a building, a person, a place, an event, you know, a sneaking cereal out of Hewitt Dining Hall. And that corresponded to a number on the bingo ball. And so and it facilitated all sorts of memories. I mean, when we did it for our class, people were running out to buy, you know, get their t-shirts from senior week and stuff like that. We also did a Barnard trivia game. It doesn't have to be Barnard trivia, obviously. You can do any kind of trivia. We particularly recommend a platform called Kahoot, which Georgiana is quite an expert on. And so, you know, it's just more a sense of thinking a little outside the box, thinking of things. I know the class of 71 actually took the bingo idea after we did it for all reunion and used it for their class event. They had a pajama party and they used it there. Professor Chats, we've talked about a little bit. You know, again, there are different kinds of formats you can use, whether it's just having someone lecture, whether it's more of a discussion kind of a thing. So again, reach out to your liaison and they can reach out to to the professor and see what might be possible. And then themed social hours and conversations, a bit like what Judy was talking about, what Ruth was talking about, those kinds of things. Now, we know that socializing on Zoom sometimes can be great, sometimes can be problematic, especially if you get a lot of people. I mean, it's great to have a lot of people, but then what do you do with them? Because to have, you know, 50 people on one Zoom is a little overwhelming. So I'd like us to take, we have about 22 minutes left. So I'd like to just a couple of minutes, if people just want to talk about how they broke out into their discussions a little bit, you know, whether they had bigger groups, smaller groups. If I had to do it over again, I would have bigger groups and longer talking times and calibrate it based on how many people actually showed up. Rather than like our predetermined what we said we wanted to do. And I think part of this, you know,
this.
Sorry, is that me or did?
Sorry, is that me feedback? Or did, was that just feedback?
Okay. So if anyone wants to jump in on what worked well for them, I think Ruth, you know, you were saying 12 was a perfect number, and I totally agree. One of the things that we did was after our formal social engagement, I sort of said to everyone, you know, anyone who wants to hang out and essentially do a virtual, you know, hanging out on the steps and just chat, feel free. And Lacey made me the host. And it was actually the best part of that event because it was a small group and it was just totally informal and, you know, we were kind of like kicking back by then. So any suggestions for how to maximize?
Another crucial thing about the breakout rooms we discovered was there had to be a facilitator in every room. There had to be a member of the reunion committee who was comfortable facilitating conversations in every breakout room. And some of the members of the committee didn't want to do it. And so we only asked those who were comfortable doing it. These are the same people who were running virtual cocktail parties all the time.
Right.
They knew how to and how not to, which was absolutely crucial. For example, going around the room and asking everybody to introduce themselves takes up the whole time. So you had to learn how to control it. Once you learned how to control it, it was easy to do.
You have any helpful hints on how to control
that? Yes, you start by saying, we're only going to speak to what our name was when we were at Barnard, what our name is now, and where we are living now. And then the two hosts modeled it by doing it themselves. And then we asked everybody else to do it. And when somebody started going on about all the places she had lived in with her wonderful husband, one of us had to cut her short. But at least we had already modeled what had to be done.
So. Right.
Yeah, good.
Okay, excellent. Anyone else? And then the last thing is collaborating with Columbia. I know there are lots of, Lacey, I see you want to add something, but just a quick thing. If you want to do an event with your Colombian counterparts, that's perfectly great. Again, just reach out to your liaison because the Columbia classes have their own liaisons. And so think of them as like the diplomats who will negotiate a treaty between you and your Colombian counterparts.
Yeah, you said it. I couldn't.
Okay. and 81, I know you did an event with Columbia. If you felt that was something that virtually worked or didn't work?
Yeah, I think it worked really nicely. Go ahead, Wendy, it was your idea to do it.
My idea? Well, that was our idea.
Everybody's idea.
It's always our, that's the way I live.
Yeah.
You were the one who remembered how well it had worked in person and urged us to do it on Zoom. So
yes, we had a very successful one in formal reunions. So I thought it'd be fun to try again on Zoom. And we've also had mini reunions with Columbia, which is very successful along the way at the Roosevelt Hotel. We just had fun events and there's always been the ask of our classmates to have also Columbia, to see our peers. So I think it worked really wonderful. It was great to see everyone. And it took a little while for everyone to warm up. And then it kind of moved pretty fluidly, I think. It was great fun to see everyone again. It really felt like we had a reunion, although of course on Zoom. But
I think we did, right.
And I think a couple of the things that we did, I mean, Georgiana was our Barnard ambassador to Columbia, so it was totally up to her to do the scheduling. So the one downside was that people did have to choose in the class of 81 whether they wanted to come to the Columbia 81 Zoom or whether they wanted to go to the Mary Gordon book group, and you could not do those two things at the book at the same time.
That's true.
Tough choice.
But many people did come, and we primed the pump with, I was one of the people who volunteered mm-hmm. that I would tell a story if there was an empty space. And so I did that. We didn't have many empty spaces. I would say the most challenging thing is that the guys are very talkative.
They were.
Yakety, 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 yakety. All those Deborah Tannen type studies about how in a co-ed group, men talk and women defer, they are all true. And there was actually a moment where I got kind of starchy with some of them. And said, I think so-and-so has had her hand up to speak.
Well done, Jean.
I think we agreed that the next person to speak was going to be so-and-so. So I'm a professor. I was happy to do that on the spur of the moment. I do that in my classroom all the time.
Right.
But maybe it's a good thing to think about ahead of time to nominate who's going to be the person who's going to do that.
Exactly. Put someone in charge who is not afraid to wrangle everybody.
Yeah. But clearly, other than that, it was great to hear
everybody's
story. And Melissa, did you want to jump in with something?
I just wanted to say that it was, mutually, both sides really wanted this reunion and really had missed, seeing all of us and really wanted to know what we were all doing. And so it was something that both sides really wanted to be a part of.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. All right, we're running a little bit behind. So let's move to our last slide, which is about class books and projects. So this is like not a mandatory thing, but a lot of classes really like to have a sort of commemorative book of some ilk. Whether it's you're asking a questionnaire or you get people to submit photos or you keep an open-ended question of, what would you say to your Barnard freshman self or what have you? It's a great way to get everybody involved, like even people who can't attend or people who are not comfortable talking in a group, they can contribute. You have you can talk to the archives about getting images and whatnot. I know 1961, you guys did a great book. And just to note, basically right now, all books and montages that are virtual, which is free. So we encourage you to keep them virtual to make them accessible to all. So Carol, did you have a screen?
I do. I mean, I have a copy of the actual book, but we can look at parts of it and I can share that, which is fine if you just...
Okay, let's do that for just like a minute and we'll just kind of quickly show you what one possible book might look like.
While Carol's getting it up on her screen, I will say that we had more contributions to this class book than any class book we'd ever done. Mm-hmm. So many.
What do you account that for? Is it just, the class was just really engaged? Was it because of the run-up? Was it because it was virtual?
It may have been because we suggested that they write about anything they wanted to write about.
Oh, all right. Well,
what you had, I think, I don't remember the number, we had initially 75 contributions. And then it went out with 75 as a PDF to the whole class. And then five other classmates said, oh my goodness, I want to add something. And so we had a second edition. So Carol, are you going to share your screen?
I'm just, it's asking me to unlock it. Now I've got it. Okay. For some strange reason, it was asking me questions and I'm a Zoom master and it never asked me them before, so you wouldn't expect it. But let's see if it's going to work or not.
Carol is the person who designed the book.
All right, Carol, while you're getting that up, I'm just going to talk a little bit about video montages.
Okay. Go ahead.
Here we go. Okay.
But I just want to tell you briefly that I was not even in at the very beginning of the book. I was, and this is a lesson to be learned, I was not like Ruth, who was president of our class at some point when we were students. Between in the 60 years, I came to our milestone reunion, but I was never involved in any other way. And guess what? I'm co-president of the class now. So I was sucked in. And because the committee that wanted to put together the book needed someone that could design it and work with it. And one person reached out and knew that I did technical things. And all of a sudden, I was involved. And I'm very happy to be here. But it's something, when you're looking to form your committee, you can look for certain skills that you need. Mm-hmm. And that will help you find it. So here, because I had the ability to work with different Adobe products and whatever, we were able to do a lot. And my question was to, we had an editor and she did a wonderful job in terms of reaching out and reviewing things when they came in. I said, how many entries do you think we'll have? And she said, I don't know, maybe 12, 15. Well, we ended up with 80. And because I was the only one who knew the software, I handled every page. But we also had somebody we assigned who could work with photographs. So it was our choice to put in, and we went into a mortarboard and we got a picture of what was in mortarboard, which Naomi got, and we asked people to send pictures of what they look like now. So this happened to be an artist, so we put in some of her artwork.
Carol, I think let's not show more of the individual pages, just in case people.
This is an individual page.
No. I mean, but just so that if someone didn't give their permission to have their stuff.
All right. So yeah. We got pictures. If there were items in the stories that related to things, we were able to get pictures about from the archives as well. And so that was what we did. It was the whole look of it, but then also putting a lot of pictures in. And then, because we talked about where people were, I'm going to go all the way to the end. This was a suggestion of Arlene, who was our editor. We talked about where people were on the map. So I'm going all the way down to our maps.
I love it.
And we worked on maps, and they are actually clickable. So that I'm New Jersey. I'm going to click on New Jersey. And there we listed exactly which towns in every one of those states we had students from our class. So that was kind of fun.
Very nice.
So, and now we actually, after the maps, you'll see we have a part two. This may not be the final one. This may be the one before. We added a few more essays because then people were really, really sorry, and we have a memoriam, that they hadn't sent something in. Topics were suggested, but that didn't mean that people stuck to those topics. They wrote about what they wanted to. We limited them to one page, recommended 500 words approximately, which, you know, would fit on a page. So those were the guidelines. And it worked really well for us.
Fantastic. So that is one amazing example. I can tell you for our 15th, we sent out a questionnaire with everything from like, what are you doing? Do you have, you know, what's with your family? Are you married, a divorce, in a relationship? What was your favorite hangout spot on campus? What was your best New York City discovery? So there's lots of different ways to go about this. And this is one amazing way to do it. The last thing, and then we'll have just a few minutes for Q&A. The last thing is video montages, which can be anything. It can be, you know, a then and now. It can be, we did a montage of, we did a little then and now, but mostly we asked people to send, you know, pictures of their enormous 80s hair and put it together. And we had a classmate who put it together with help from her teenage son and added some 80s music. And it was great. We actually did that at our in-person reunion for our 25th, as well as we did a new montage for our 30th and showed it while people were coming into the way, you know, into the room for our social event. So lots of different ideas, lots of different ways to go about them. Please note that Alumnae Relations can help you if you make a YouTube video and you'd like to upload it. They can help you upload it to a private link on the Alumnae Relations page. Just give them a 2-week leeway time to kind of get all that done. Again, your liaison can help, and just reach out to them once you start having meetings and creating stuff. Okay, so I think we're going to go to the very last slide, which is, interested in joining your class reunion committee? We have an answer for you. Just email reunion@barnard.edu and stay tuned for an email from your alumni relations class liaison. You know, if you know your class officers, you can also reach out to them and say, hey, I'm interested. I highly recommend that class officers reach out to your friends and you know, people who you were close to in college, and say, hey, you know, I'm president, I'm vice president, I'm the class correspondent, I'm a class agent, and we're getting together a reunion committee, and we'd love to have you as part of it. We'd love to have your input. We'd love to have you represent the West Coast or what have you. Okay, I think we have a few questions that we can go to. I know there was one about alcohol times on the West Coast from Erica from O2. What time of day, day of the week, do people think is best for an alcohol Zoom? I did many on Saturday at 6 p.m., which was great, but that would be 3 p.m. California time and perhaps not good. As I wrote in the chat, I think that's a really good reason to have representatives from different places on the globe, because they'll tell you. My West Coast friends were like, yeah, it doesn't matter. We're like used to accommodating Eastern time. So just do it. To me, 6 p.m. and 3 p.m. sound perfectly legit on a Saturday or a Sunday, but maybe that's just me.
Well, it doesn't work for Europe and Israel.
Well, there you go. I mean, and that's, you know, and that's something you're going to have to decide. And that's it's both the curse and the blessing of virtual. Yes, there's more, you know, you can engage people from around the world, but, you know, you want to find a time that works for everyone. Again, if you get a lot of people internationally involved, then, you know, you can create something that works for them.
The solution is to just drop the liquor. I mean, we call them virtual cocktail parties, but yeah. Nobody was asked what she was drinking.
I think
we did find a time that was, I think, a reunion. Lacey, it was 2 o'clock?
I think maybe 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock Eastern.
Yeah. Something like that, included every except the woman in Australia.
Yeah. And so I think once you do have, you know, a core group of volunteers or people who want to be involved, you can talk, you know, maybe even at your first meeting about what time would work best, because that you know, worked well. And so we planned all of our subsequent meetings for the whole committee at that time, because it worked for, you know, the majority of people. And we kept everyone else in the loop if they weren't able to make it.
Great. Jean asked an interesting question about how to involve people who are self-conscious. I've had people feel reunion wasn't for them because they hadn't gone on to professional careers or because they hadn't married or had children. And I always tell them that they're all welcome.
Zoom.
Zoom, I think is, yeah, I think Zoom partly is a great equalizer. And also, you know, if you keep it more about, like one of the things I loved about Barnard Bingo is like the pull of nostalgia is really big. And also everyone has some sort of memory from being at college. Like, the, you know, we were all on an even, well, more or less on an even playing field there, right? It was all about classes and social and whatever. And so if maybe using that as a common denominator, I mean, you know, it's not easy being a Barnard alum. You are constantly putting yourself up against all sorts of other people and it is very intimidating. And I totally get that. And I, you know, if it's maybe a one-on-one conversation with someone and just say, you know, it doesn't matter. It's we want you for you as a kind of thing. But if anyone has any quick advice.
Well, one thing I think from, I remember with working with both the classes of 61 and 69, I think in the approach for the class book in particular, just making it very open-ended and making sure that like providing examples to say, you know, this, you know, whether you did this or did this or, you know, or you didn't, you know, we want your story to be told. And I think that helped in both of those cases to make people feel welcome.
And again, I think, you know, one of the themes, right? Okay, so Francis, in 1 second. I think one of the themes was, right, if you were using Zoom and we have all these different people from all these different parts of the world, you know, you get a wider range of experience. And hopefully that then contributes to creating a more varied reunion experience too. Francis?
I only wanted to say that, and I have several classmates here on the call, that I wasn't involved at all for 30 years, period. And one of our classmates reached out to me individually, and then she said, well, it's really not as intimidating as you think. After all, we're having hors d'oeuvres from symposium and wine. How bad can it be? And it was, well, I said, I don't even know any of these people. And it was like, but we know each other now. We can get to know each other. And now I'm much more engaged with my class than I ever was or ever considered being or ever thought I would be. And so you need to just reach out to the people who are not there, whose name is on the list and you have no idea who they are. Right. Because you weren't friends in college. We have a lot of those people who are in our class group now that really weren't friends back then. And they came with one other person.
It's exactly, Francis, why our virtual cocktail parties worked so well.
Yeah.
Because we just invited people because they were English majors. Didn't matter what their careers were. It didn't matter. whether they were married, divorced 6 times and had 2 children and or no children. We're talking about who was your favorite professor and why did you major in this and did it work out to be a lifetime commitment or not?
Perfect. Perfect. Well, I think on that note, we're going to have to wrap it up. Gosh, thank you to everyone, first of all, for coming, for contributing. Thank you so much to our reunion committee panelists for telling us about their experiences and to Alumni Relations for making this happen in a very, very busy time. Just a quick reminder that October 20th is Giving Day, which is a great time to start your reunion year fundraising. And also October 29th is Leadership Assembly, to which, because it's virtual, everyone is invited. You know, as many members of your class can attend as you want. So please feel free to register. Information will be forthcoming. If you still have some questions or have ideas or just feel free to reach out to me or to Alumni Relations at reunion@barnard.edu. But I hope that this has given you all some food for thought and gotten the ideas churning. And I can't wait to see what you all come up with. And we on the reunion, the AABC reunion committee, will be working away, I promise you, to make reunion 2022 as special and amazing as your classes. No matter whether we're in person or on Zoom or a combination of both. So I'm going to sign off with what I've been doing in my reunion welcome speeches, which is stay safe, stay strong, stay bold, and stay Barnard. Good night, everyone. Thank you.
Good night. Thank you. Yeah.